Now I feel it a rare privilege for me to introduce Dr. Srivari Chandrasekhar, our next speaker in the program. Dr. Srivari Chandrasekhar, born in 1964, completed his primary and higher education in Hyderabad and joined CSIR, IICT for PhD program. After completing his PhD with the then director, Dr. A.V. Ramarao, he moved to USA for a postdoctoral position with the Professor J.R. Falk. He joined CSIR IICT as Scientist C in 1994 and grew up to the level of Director in 2015. He is a fellow of all the three Indian Scientist Academies, National Academy of Sciences, Indian Academy of Sciences, and Indian National Science Academy. He is also an Alexander von Humboldt Fellow. He has made significant contributions in diverse areas of organic chemistry with a special emphasis on chiral chemistry, total synthesis of biologically active natural products and pharmaceutical products. He introduced polyethyl glycol. He has developed technologies for the synthesis of latest anti-tuberculosis drug, bedaquilin anti-tumor and abortive drug, misoprostol anti-pellet molecule, beraprost anti-depressive compound, sterling and drug for treatment of schizophrenia, esnopine. He has more than 285 publications with 7,600 citations. 80 students have been already awarded PhD degree under his able guidance, and 20 postdoctoral associates have worked in this group. He has received several accolades, including Eminent Scientist Award for contributions in the field of chemistry from Telangana State Government in 2017, C.N.R. Rao National Prize for Chemical Research 2012, CSIR Technology Award 2014, and Infosys Prize in Chemical Sciences 2014 for his contributions in synthetic organic chemistry, with a special focus on the synthesis of complex molecules from natural resources and innovative practical approaches to pharmaceutical of current interest to industry. So, sir, I now request Dr. Srivari Chandrasekhar G to address the audience.
Before that, one Geet by Krishnamurthy, madam.
Namaste, am I audible?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Greetings to all of you on this very important 75th India's Independence Day. I'm sure today, while we cherish the flag hoisting and interacting with friends and families, I think it's more so to connect with our friends on Vignan Bharati and see what is that we as the scientific community do that India really becomes truly Atmanirbhar. While science has no boundaries, I think whatever we discover, someone has taken and used it. And similarly, someone has discovered and we took it and used it. So while we believe that science has no boundaries, but certainly India has to be a global leader, then only I think we are respected and we will not require to depend on the West, as many speakers have told at the beginning. While the topic given to me today was to say a few words on the two legendary Indian scientists, Vai Subbarao and Acharya P.C. Ray, I thought it's also a forum to alert all of our friends on the call today, the alerts given by the United Nations on the global warming, the climate change, and what is that we should do. Also, I would like to recollect what Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji has told in the morning. What is that we as researchers have to do for farming community, agriculture, and villages? I think end of the day, India's pillars and integrity is built on these villages and farmers who still continue to contribute 70% of our economy and also livelihood. What is that we as Vignan Bharati friends do for this community? There's also a wonderful quote made by Professor Acharya P.C. Ray. While I'm talking about Acharya Ray and Professor Subbarao, I also would like to make a statement that IICT just has built a bust of Acharya P.C. Ray, and we are waiting for one of our guests, chief guests, to come and unravel this bust, that every day we could cherish P.C. Ray's bust and get motivated from the contributions he has done. he made a statement, science can wait, but Swaraj cannot wait. I think that was the pre-independence. I think as we all know, both of them were more patriotic Indians trying to see how India can get independence than what is their personal contribution or what is that they would like to do for science. I think that dream of Acharya P.C. Ray has come true. And today we need to realize that now Swaraj has come, science cannot wait. So science was waiting for Swaraj, and finally Swaraj has come 75 years ago, but now I think science cannot wait. Similarly, the kind of contributions Professor Subbarao has made, I think many, many speakers have told, but have more organized content of what Professor Subbarao has done. So I would like to again greet all of you on this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. And both of them, Subbarao and also P.C. Ray, come from different parts of our country, but both have strived towards one common goal, which is the affordable healthcare. I think that is where, again, I think Government of India has launched many programs on affordable healthcare, where we are trying to provide healthcare to all the needy in this country. The Jan Aushadhi scheme of the current government, I think, is miles ahead compared to many other countries. And this Jan Aushadhi scheme would provide affordable healthcare to all the needy in our country. Sri Ellapreti Subbarao Garu was, of course, born in Bhimaram, and he was a biochemist by training. As many of us know that he attempted to go to medical school, but unfortunately, because he was not given a full degree, and then he had to work in an Ayurvedic college. We all look at Ayurveda as a second line of treatment, and we all look at modern science, the so-called modern science, which evolved in the last 100 years, 150 years, with some rational look at it as the frontline science. But we all know that the traditional healthcare systems of Indian origin, Chinese origin, and some of the healthcare systems evolved in the European world have to be embraced to make sure that how modern drugs also would come in. As again, one of our speakers mentioned, Subbarao started wearing khadi, followed Gandhiji. He also boycotted all the British goods. This act, actually, this is where I think he was not given the degree. Instead of giving an MBBS degree, which all I think is the biggest degree one could get, he was given the licentiate of medicine. I think it's like a diploma in medicine and surgery, LMS, instead of a bachelor's degree in the medical sciences. I think this forced him to downplay himself and start working under someone else. I think as we knew that he had to work in the foreign countries with a lower degree, that's why he was not given a full job. And then when he joined the Lederle Laboratories, I think that is where lots and lots of innovations and discoveries have happened. And these discoveries are the hallmark of Professor Subbarao's contribution. Also, when we look at some of the tributes given to him by the Western world, I think it is not that he was ignored. It's not that he was not recognized. I think some of the major newspapers, today also we look at them as the world leaders in the media, like New York Times, New York Herald, Tribune, and many newspapers across the world have honored him as a distinguished scientist. He was also bestowed upon with one of the most eminent medical minds of the century by the National Herald. I think this is the biggest honor I'm sure everyone would like to cherish, and I think he was given this. Also, the publications he has done in very important journals like Science, Journal of American Chemical Society. I think with all the investments today the Government of India makes on all of us scientists on the call today, it's so difficult to publish a paper in Science, or almost impossible for many Indians to publish a paper in Science or Nature or Journal of American Chemical Society. And Professor Subbarao was able to publish multiple articles in those journals as independent author and also as a co-author with multiple collaborations. His scientific success stories with the discovery of Fiske Subbarao method. Again, most of us would like to have one name reaction or one name after what we discover, like C.V. Raman effect. The Raman effect, I think, as we were talking of in the Association of Cultivation of Science, the Governing Council, which I personally chair, I think we could go and see when the instrument was not there. I think as our DRGO friend Rao was mentioning, if instrument was not there, I think we don't give up the science. What we do is you make the instrument yourself. I think that is what C.V. Raman has done. He made a small Raman equipment, went on to make the Raman measurements, and which won him the Nobel Prize. I think one message today, I think Professor Rao was trying to give to all of us. I think science cannot be driven by the instruments. They may give you some precision, but I think the passion and what is that I am doing today will be useful to tomorrow's citizens of this planet. I think that should drive the science. Not that you buy the best equipment in the world, paying $10 million or $500 million, generate a lot of data and publish few papers and get a personal recognition. I think that's not what Subbarao wanted, nor Professor P.C. Ray wanted. Again, I think Professor Subbarao's contributions in discovering the ATP. I think ATP is a household name, adenosine triphosphate, which is the energy provider in the entire biochemical process. The research on ATP earned him a PhD degree. I think while he could not complete the MBBS and became a doctorate degree, I think he would do a PhD in biochemistry using his ATP discovery. And then he got a fellowship from the Rockefeller Foundation. This again, a very noteworthy recognition. He got it. The vitamin B12 contribution he has made. The nutrition science he has developed. Folic acid. Then of course, the anti-cancer drug, which he discovered again, that has changed many, many lives. I think this again was a contribution when he was working between 1953 to 64 in the Lederle labs, which was useful in the pediatric leukemia. So when you look at methotrexate, again, a great innovation. For me, when I look at the profile of Professor Subbarao, it's very difficult to understand whether he's a medical doctor, is he a biochemist, or is an organic chemist. He has done more organic chemistry than well-trained organic chemist in Harvard's and MIT's. I think that makes Professor Subbarao a very, very unique individual. Also, the tetracycline contributions, again, I think which have changed the world. I think many, many people were dying of infections and his innovations in tetracyclines, especially the chlorotetracycline, which was an important innovation. This has helped save many, many, many lives. And that was part of the list of essential medicines. Today, we talk of the cost of medicines has to come down. We are talking of many schemes of the government of India. I think those days, he was able to make all these drugs as affordable as possible. Similarly, Subbarao's work was also made a very important game-changing contributions during the World War II. He was constantly raising his sights. His next targets were always on the polio and also on cancer. We know that today, thanks to Dr. Harshvardhan, who was our health minister before, during his time under Atal Bihari Vajpayee's government, he was the one who made sure that India became a polio-free country. No one thought that India could vaccinate so many people at one point of time. Despite the best investments made by China, America, I think India has given 50 crore vaccine shots to all our citizens, which is highest by any standards. The way we handle the pandemics, I think no one can match Indian commitment. So we don't require to worry that India is an inferior country in science. I think we do innovations. While they may not be as large as looking at the Western world, but when need arises, I think Indians rise to the occasion and make sure that we make what India needs. Who thought that from the day pandemic began, a Hyderabad-based company, Bharat Biotech, could launch a vaccine in less than a year, while Pfizer Moderna launched within a couple of weeks of their approvals from the regulators, Indian vaccines got approvals. I think this is the power of Indian science, and I think we all cherish the great contributions made by these people. While many people argue that Professor Subbarao would have got multiple Nobel Prizes, we all know Nobel Prize is given to one contribution. I think you need to excel in one area. And when Professor Subbarao excelled in so many areas, I'm sure the Nobel Committee could not decide in which area they have to give Nobel Prize to this great legend. I think Nobel Prize is at his feet. I think he does not require Nobel Prize to recognize Professor Subbarao. Also, when we look at his centenary in 1994, one great statement made by one of the critics, Professor Pushpamitra Bhargav, while he always was not talking of the Indian science or traditional science, is a very critique, devil's advocate. But I think he is the man who had to put one statement. I do not believe there is any other person in the documented history of biology and medicine over the last 5,000 years who has made more contributions than Professor Subbarao. I think this is another tribute we can always pay. And on this important 75 years of India's independence, it's great that Vigyan Bharati has taken the names of Professor Subbarao and Acharya Ray, and we remember them, get motivated, and see how we make India truly Atmanirbhar. Coming back to Acharya P.C. Ray, again, very dear to my heart, I'm a practicing organic chemist. He made the first Indian chemical industry, Bengal Chemicals. We all were making a lot of noise on hydroxychloroquine. Again, Bengal Chemicals was the first company in India to make chloroquine. He's certainly and truly, while we looked at Mahatma Gandhi as father of the nation, Acharya P.C. Ray is the father of chemistry in India. So again, this great man, a teacher, someone who before even retirement started donating his pension to the needy. I think something we need to emulate. What is that this country has given to me is always we argue. But here is a man who went on to keep donating even his pension money, salary to the needy, and see that science flourishes, healthcare flourishes, and Indian science flourishes. The kind of recognitions he has got, again, topper in science, all through his education was in Calcutta. The names like Vidyasagar University is the one where he studied his primary education. He went to UK, Edinburgh. He came back to India. He had obtained letters of introduction from many, many Western professors, but still he was not given a full professor job in the Indian university. He has to begin as an assistant professor, but I think he has not grumbled. I think today's generation, we all look at if one promotion is not given on time, delayed by a few months or a couple of years, I think we will become so restless. But here he was a man, when he was not given a professor job, he did not say, I will not join a job. I think he joined and proved his mettle. Position doesn't matter, but what science I do matters. I think this is something, again, we need to emulate and educate our younger generation. That don't look at someone will come and recognize you. I think you do what is best for the country and country will recognize you. If not, they recognize you when you're alive, it will recognize after you leave this planet. I think that's more important. We should recognize after we leave what the legacy, what we have to do. He was again one of those great leaders who wanted to teach science in the native languages so that your thought processes will be natural. So he went on to start teaching chemistry in Bengali language. I think this kind of thought processes which he has inculcated into all of us make India truly Atmanirbhar in the chemical sector. Today, entire world look at India as the pharma hub, the chemical hub. While we were not able to do entire backward integration end-to-end like China has done, but still majority of the drugs what world needs are made in our great country. I think that legacy was built by this great man. Also, the book he has written, The History of the Hindu Chemistry. I think this is something I invite all my friends on the call today. If they get an opportunity, I think they should go back and see what is this history of Hindu chemistry, the kind of science we had. But I think we should not get into complacency that India was a great country. Qutub Minar had the best metallurgy we have made. Tipu Sultan's world is best in the world. I think we don't require to cherish on what was discovered. But I think what is tomorrow? What is tomorrow is how India could become the world leader in science and technology. More than science and technology, how we will teach ethics in science to the world. Today, we all know that to get recognitions in science and technology, ethics are compromised. So can we also tell to the world, the ethics what we have learned from the leaders is spread to the world so that the science done is with the true commitment and tomorrow you don't require to retract a publication. Our science is not reproducible. He was a great follower of Mahatma Gandhi. He comes from elite family. And Gandhiji called him, Mahatma Gandhiji called him Doctor of Floods. I think again, another great recognition what P.C. Ray could get. And he was part of Presidency College. He retired from Presidency College. And his contributions are enormous. In recognition of Praful Chandra's great work, he was elected as President of the Indian Science Congress and Indian Chemical Society more than once. The Life and Experience of Bengal Chemist was a book written, and this book is again about what P.C. Ray has done to our country. Praful Chandra Ray was very affectionate towards his students. He was overjoyed when they received awards and honors. Again, something we need to learn from Professor P.C. Ray. He was the one who wanted his students should get more recognition and more awards and rewards than what he has gained. I think he was not like Dronacharya, that my student should not be better than I, or I take two students and one student should be better than the other student. I think he has made sure that all his students do better than him in life, better than him in discoveries, and better than him in charities, what they have done. I think this is what we need to learn from him. He would never allow anyone to come and open his car door. Today, I think with mediocre kind of positions we have, we expect our driver to open the door, not someone to clean our car seat. But I think he was the man, I think, who said, no one should open my car door. I wash my own clothes. I polish my shoes. I think these are some of the discipline which we need to bring back. And I'm sure Vignan Bharati would start educating in this important year of 75 years. The kind of happiness you get by doing your own things, I think that joy we need to inculcate in your next generation. And of course, today, while we remember these two great scientists, there are many more great scientists India can remember, as someone mentioned about J.C. Bose. We are seeing Professor Sukhdev, who was a great scientist in the National Chemical Laboratory, Pune, went on to work in Baroda Institute, who made the first drug, how Ayurvedic drugs could be taken into modern science and give validation so that the Western world could accept our medicines. So I think there are many, many great scientists, and we all remember all of them, their contributions. If they are not there, we salute them. Alive, I think we go and touch their feet, take their blessings. I think this is how we take them as role models. One thing we need to educate our young scientists, that everyone should have their own role model, and see that we inculcate the great characters of the role model and become better than the role model. I think this is what we all would like to do. And again, I would like to personally thank Vignan Bharati team of Andhra Pradesh for giving this opportunity a platform for all of us to interact. While there are some technical glitches, but I think we are all able to connect. And I wish all of you again a very happy Independence Day. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. That's a wonderful speech. Yes, the passion. What is that I am doing it now, today? I should be important for tomorrow. Yes, we should all inculcate the habit of being a role model. And it's a wonderful speech, sir. As we have come to the most important part of our program, I request Professor Ruchir Guptaji to address the gathering.
Thank you, madam. Thanks for nice introduction and giving me opportunity to share my thoughts with such a great and honored speakers and audience of with their most learned abilities. Today is 15th August and we are celebrating Independence Day. In fact, Independence Day, as Professor Avdhani said, is not the right term for that. So we should say that we are celebrating Satantrata Devas, and it is the 74th Satantrata Devas of our Rashtra. And from this day, we are entering into the 75th year. And as you have told, that we are going to celebrate Amrit Mahotsav across the country. Government, all the organizations are celebrating it. And so Vignan Bharati is also participating in that with full enthusiasm. And this is one example of that enthusiasm. So at all the places, in all the states, we are organizing such programs. On 15th August 1947, the long gloomy night of servitude of several centuries faded away. And the lotus of freedom bloomed. Bharat Mata became free from the clutches of oppressive foreign rule. It was happened 75 years ago, so it is 1947. In these 75 years, we have moved a lot, and it's a moment of joy and pride to celebrate this 74th Independence Day. At the same time, it is most opportune time to remember, feel gratitude to all those who struggled for Swatantrata, who were the reason for Swatantrata to come. All who contributed immensely and dedicated the best of their life to achieve Swatantrata. And when we talk about this, generally we talk about political activists and revolutionary people. Just an example that happened with me only. When I asked my 13-year-old son, with few names, the names were Subhash Chandra Bose, and then Satyendranath Bose, Jagdish Chandra Basu, Bhagat Singh. And I asked who all actually contributed for the independence, for the Swatantrata. He said, you have written these names incorrectly. So Satyendranath Bose and Jagdish Chandra Bose, in his opinion, was incorrect names for Swatantrata. And it is not limited to him. It is a general perception that we have. And we generally don't recognize the contribution of scientists and the people promoting science in the colonial period. So this is probably the right time to understand that and paying tribute to them. I'll come back to that. But before, let's understand the invasions that was made in our country. So our country faced repeated invasions. Maybe in 500 years it was quite clear. Mughal invasion was there. And then the last invasion was British invasion. Mughals and previous invaders were no way less greedy and cruel than English people, than Britishers. But Britishers damaged us a lot. When Britishers came to our country, our GDP was somewhere around 19-20%. And when they left, it was somewhere around 3%. So what was the reason that actually gave them enough opportunity or to rob us? How could they loot us in such a great to such a great extent? If we observe this clearly, carefully, we see that they came with a tool that was not available with previous invaders. And this magical tool was science. So Britishers came with science. They used science to strengthen their colonial period and to rob, to loot much than the previous invaders. In fact, the examples that we see after the Battle of Plassey, in fact, it is actually not just to call that battle, because there was no battle that actually happened in a way. Clive Lloyd just colluded with Mir Jafar and defeated Siraj ud-Daula. So, I mean, this cannot be considered as battle, but history considers that as battle. So after the Battle of Plassey, Britishers got limited rights for collecting taxes in a very small part of our country. And even then, in 1767, when they were not there in the country, I mean, a very small part of country, they were available. I mean, they were actually kind of ruling. It was not rule. They were actually collecting taxes for that. Clive Lloyd established one institution that he named as Survey of India. Although it will be little different from the subject we are discussing, but it is also probably worth mentioning that somehow we missed that Survey of India was established by East India Company, one of the officers of East India Company. It was never established by Government of India. Actually, there was no Government of India at that time, but DST on its website mentions that Survey of India was the first institution established by Government of India. So yeah, it was not an institution established by Government of India. It was established by East India Company, and that was established for what reason? So that was established for understanding the wealth of our nation, so that they can extract the wealth in the most efficient way. And then Survey of India was the first institution of its type, and then Geological Survey of India, and there were many survey agencies were actually instituted. If we'll see carefully, for a very long time, until they start establishing universities, they were the only research institutions they were establishing were actually survey institutions. And probably the basic idea was to understand the country properly, to capitalize is not the right word, to exploit the resources as much as possible, and they were somehow successful in doing that. And by doing science, they can not only exploit our country, but they can also build a narrative that they are superior to Indians in terms of understanding and in terms of brain, etc. When some force wants to capture some country, there are two things generally they go for. First, to acquire as much as wealth possible, and second, to establish a superiority on them so that they feel inferior and they can accept their rule. And Britishers were quite successful in that way. When our Indian scientists, of course, they were trained in Western system, they understood this idea, and the people who actually supported science understood this idea, they struggled against that and uphold the national pride. And this idea of struggle and upholding the national pride actually missed out somewhere. So generally people say that Satyagraha was started by Mahatma Gandhi. But if we'll see carefully, Jagdish Chandra Basu actually did Satyagraha well before that. So when he came back from his studies and tried to join Survey of India, Imperial Education Services. So at that time, there were two kind of education services, Indian Education Services and Imperial Education Services. In Indian Education Services, there were people with Indian origin, and for the same kind of job, Britishers were paid 3 to 4 times extra than in comparison with Indians. So when Jagdish Chandra Basu applied for Imperial Education Services, despite of all his qualification, he was told that Indians cannot think rationally, and so they cannot understand or teach science. So the point that was told to him was not actually told to Jagdish Chandra Basu. It was never said that Jagdish Chandra Basu is not rational thinker and he cannot understand science. It was told for the Indians. Jagdish Chandra Basu actually realized that it is being set for my country, and then he did Satyagraha in his own way. So he started teaching without taking any salary and without any lab. After 3 years of teaching without salary, finally English people, Britishers, have to recognize him, and they paid all salary and the residual salary and the current salary, and gave him proper position in Imperial Education Service. And in this time, he had to sold his land, everything. So that was a very difficult time, and he continued to do experimentation all the time. Another instance of Jagdish Chandra Basu that is also quite discussed, I'll just restate that once again. So after Maxwell's equation, Maxwell's discovery, microwaves were to be transmitted in a wireless medium. In fact, it was millimeter wave, it was not microwave that Jagdish Chandra Basu worked with. So Jagdish Chandra Basu demonstrated this transmission for the first time in the world. At that time, these irrational Indians who performed this, the rational Britishers or rational Europeans or rational so-called rational Americans could never do that. It was the irrational Indians in terms of Britishers who could do that. So again, I mean, it was not properly recognized. And the Nobel that was supposed to be given to Acharya Basu was ultimately given to Marconi for almost similar kind of experiment. Very late in 2012 or so, it was recognized by IEEE, and now they recognize that it was a contribution by Jagdish Chandra Basu. But I mean, it was too long that time actually passed away. Jagdish Chandra Basu was a great scientist, we all know, and he was a believer of open knowledge system. Our Indian system is about open knowledge, so nobody talks about charging something for knowledge. After acquiring all the knowledge, all the wisdom from Guru, a Shishya just devotes Guru Dakshina to his Guru. So there is no fee that should be charged for knowledge, it should be free. Jagdish Chandra Basu was actually a true believer of that. So he always actually said that there should be no patent, and he almost never patented except once for his knowledge. So this is the way he actually uphold the national pride and make all of us pride, and proved repeatedly that Indians are rational thinkers and they are generally better science people than anybody in the world. Another very prominent name that we can talk, we can discuss regarding this is Dr. Mahendra Lal Sarkar. Mahendra Lal Sarkar himself was a physician. He was not a scientist, but he did a lot for promoting science. So earlier, he was the chairman of British Medical Council of West Bengal. And he was a staunch critic of homeopathy. In fact, he delivered a lecture while criticizing homeopathy, and that was widely appreciated. He was a very highly paid physician and a very famous physician of his time. Then somehow he came in contact with the real literature of homeopathy. Some of his friend gifted him a book of homeopathy and requested him to read it in a critical fashion. When he read that book, he realized that there is a science behind homeopathy. So then he presented his understanding in British Medical Council. The group of medical practitioners, most of them were Britishers. Mahendra Lal Sarkar was the second MD of his time, who claimed to be rational. They did not actually took this in a positive way. Lot of criticism had to faced by Dr. Mahendra Lal Sarkar. Not only that, they tried to spoil his practice and everything. And in one time, his practice got actually finished, and then he started working on homeopathy, and then again same kind of reputation. Eventually, Dr. Sarkar realized the importance of promotion of Indian science, and then he established one association that was the first association of its time, Indian Association for Cultivation of Science, in 1876, and he devoted 10 years of his time for establishing this Indian Association of Cultivation of Science. It was the first association that was funded and run by Indians. It was involved in preparing and helping Indian scientists to compete at international level. And very soon, in form of Dr. Sir C.V. Raman, we got the reward of establishment of ISES. Sir C.V. Raman was originally an account officer. He when got posted in Kolkata, he actually used ISES as a place where he used to perform his experiments. And because of those experiments and all that inspiration, all that support that he got from ISES, lately in 1930, first Nobel Prize of our country actually went to Sir C.V. Raman. Then on the similar line, and I mean, Mahendralal Sarkar was not actually a scientist. He was somebody who was supporting scientists. So with in the same line, another name was Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya. I have taught at IIT BHU, Banaras Hindu University. So I have felt the kind of system he developed, the kind of institution he developed. But that story is for some time else. For now, I'll only discuss how he contributed to this whole endeavor. So in 1916, there was an industrial commission that was constituted. Probably many of you are aware of that. The industrial commission was constituted to understand if fiscal autonomy can be given to government of India or not. Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, lawyer by profession, was one of the honorable member of that industrial commission. It took 3 years in preparing a report. In 1919, this industrial commission gave its report. The most interesting part of this industrial commission's report was, except Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, other members were of the opinion, and in fact they proved by and large by writing their report, that India India is not an industrial country, and it requires a lot of support for promoting industries. Dr. Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya wrote a note of 55 pages. Many times people call it note of dissent. So he wrote a note of 55 pages where he, in a very logical and argumentative way, provide the rebuttal of all the claims made by the members of the commission. That industrial commission report, along with that note, is available on web. If anybody wants to interested, he can go through it. I think many of you would have seen that. This 55-page note was actually appended to the report as it is. This became for later. This became the reason and basis for establishment of Banaras Hindu University. While establishing Banaras Hindu University, he invited Sir Jagdish Chandra Basu as well. In Banaras Hindu University, he always tried to bring people from all over the world. And in a way, he actually was working on science diplomacy as well. I'll just quote one example. Actually, that was not a very successful example, but that actually shows the kind of thought and vision that Pandit Malviya, Mahamana Malviya, was having. When everything was happening with the Jews in Germany, Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya wrote a letter to Einstein inviting him to Banaras Hindu University. Interestingly, Albert Einstein accepted this offer, and he wrote a letter responding that he is interested in joining BHU. The irony was, this letter actually reached to Pandit Malviya quite late. It reached to the clerical staff of the university. And they could not actually appreciate the value of this letter, and they requested Albert Einstein to apply in a proper format. later on, when Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya got this letter, he again corresponded to Albert Einstein, and by the time he had left for United States. Just think for a minute, if this process would have been successful, what could be the fate for theory of relativity and BHU and all? And this was not the only example. He tried this with many other guys as well. So these people actually understood that science diplomacy should be there, and they tried in a very specific way of doing that. Similarly, Professor Ashutosh Mukherjee asked people to go to Germany in place of going for higher studies in place of Britain. So the idea was Shatru Mitraha. So this way they promoted that. Professor Chandrasekhar talked a lot about Acharya Praful Chandra Rai. So I'll just discuss one or two things about him, and then I'll finish to my words. So Acharya Praful Chandra Rai, as Professor Chandrasekhar mentioned, was a great nationalist. And he also said that science can wait, but Swaraj cannot. He understood the importance of industries for the independence of the nation and post-independence development of the nation. So when he understood that sulfuric acid is a very important component for today's industry, and the small factories who are producing sulfuric acid are actually not able to produce in a more efficient way, he started producing sulfuric acid, and then he tried to do whatsoever he could do. Similarly, Bengal Chemical was another venture that he tried for, and he always tried for anything that can be useful and that can promote science and industry in the country without thinking about his own interest. He, despite of being such a great researcher, there were many publications that he had in Nature and all. He always promoted and also published on his own in Indian journals. So, in a way, these people, and this is a very small list that we are talking about. There is a long list. Yella Prakata Subhat is another example to that, of scientists and people promoting science in our country, who actually helped Swatantrata struggle and uphold the national pride, who established in a way that Indians are rational thinkers and they can do science better than anybody else in the world. So now it is the right time to realize this and recognize their contribution in the Swatantrata Sangram. So I hope, in this whole year, as the programs described by Sri Shastri Ji, we'll be organizing this, and eventually we'll be able to reach people with this kind of narrative. Thank you for giving me opportunity to share my thoughts with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving us an extensive idea about indigenous science. And now I request Sri Yashwant Ji, lecturer, Government Polytechnic College, Srikakulam, to propose a befitting vote of thanks.
I would like to thank the guests of this session, Sri G. Narasimha Rao sir, Director General DRDO New Delhi, and Dr. Srivari Chandrasekhar sir, Director IICT CSR Hyderabad, and Professor Ruchir Gupta sir, JNU New Delhi, and all other dignitaries in the panel, on the behalf of Bharatiya Vignana Mandali, AP chapter of Vignana Bharati. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for all the participants who attended to this program. We hope this session will surely going to encourage all the participants to take the Indian science and unsung Indian scientists like Ella Pragada Subbarao and all others to all corners of this nation. We hope with the grace and will of ancient sages who were the ancient scientists of this land, may work through you to take the Indian science to the common man, to make India as a leading nation in science. Once again, from the core of my heart, I am expressing our sincere thanks to all Karyakartas of Bharatiya Vignana Mandali making this program successful.